When it comes to the nuclear talks between Iran and the international community, no country is watching as closely as Israel. Its air force has struck repeatedly at Iranian supplies and munitions wherever it can find them. This week, Conflict Zone talks to the former Israeli Defense Minister, Moshe Ya'alon, who slammed the 2015 nuclear agreement as an historic mistake. Talks or no talks, Israel, he says, has just one priority.
The Israeli policy is very clear. By one way or another, the military nuclear project in Iran should be stopped.
We also talk about the spike in violent attacks by Jewish settlers against Palestinians. More than 400 were logged last year alone. Why is the state so reluctant to confront these settlers? And what of the Israeli army, which the UN accuses of standing by and letting the attacks happen? Also, a shocking instruction that at least one Israeli soldier was given by his commanders about treating Palestinian prisoners. All that and more on Conflict Zone. General Moshe Ya'alon, welcome to Conflict Zone.
Thank you for having me.
When the West signed the nuclear deal with Iran in 2015, you joined the chorus of protest against it. You said it was a threat to world peace, a reward for uninhibited terror, an historic mistake. Now, ever since Trump withdrew from the accord, you've wished it was still in force. You've even called his withdrawal the main mistake of the last decade in Iran policy. It's a bit late to cry crocodile tears over a deal you rejected outright when it was signed, isn't it?
I believe that a JCPOA of 2015 was an historic mistake, as I believe there was an opportunity because of the pressure imposed upon the Iranian regime to reach more in this specific deal. Nevertheless, the idea of leaving the JCPOA led by President Trump was another mistake. There wasn't a plan B when President Trump decided to leave the deal, actually to violate it, without any plan. And by doing it, he lost the international coalition, and the Iranian had the excuse to go ahead with the project without any limitation.
You failed to see any good in the agreement when it was signed, and you crucially failed to look ahead and appreciate how bad things might get without such an agreement. How did you get it so wrong?
The agreement was a missing opportunity, as I believe that it comes to what should be done now. In 2012, President Khamenei came to the table under pressure. He was told by his economist that the Iranian regime would be able to survive another year or year and a half in his strategy, in which he was challenged by international coalition, isolating him in the international arena, creeping economic sanctions, which is the main tool, and a credible military option. That's why in 2012 he was ready to be engaged with the great Satan, with America, with many apologies to explain it.
What was so terrible about this agreement? It extended the time Iran would need to obtain enough fissile material for a bomb. It obliged Iran to scale back uranium enrichment for up to 15 years. It dramatically reduced the number of centrifuges by two-thirds, in fact, and it allowed for rigorous inspection of Iranian nuclear facilities. How was that an historic mistake? Let's be honest, the historic mistake was yours in condemning that deal, wasn't it?
Tim, you are very right. But the JCPOA, the agreement, didn't deal with the missile project, with the proliferation of arms and terror, which are still relevant today, as we witnessed yesterday, by the Iranian attack on the UAE targets in Abu Dhabi. And it ignored the military dimensions of the project. Unfortunately, in 2015, the U.S. administration was in a hurry to reach an agreement rather than to deal with all those issues. And that was a mistake.
Yeah, but no such thing as a perfect deal, is there? You of all people should know that. You get what you can at the time and you build on it. That's how it works, doesn't it?
I claimed and I still claim that we would have reached more. Nevertheless, that's why I criticize the Trump initiative to violate the deal. As we had the deal, it was actually done deal. He should kept it and come with a new strategy using crippling sanctions to put the Iranian regime again under pressure, to have a credible military option, and to try to have an international coalition to isolate the regime. By these three elements, which might be still relevant to the Biden administration today.
You're talking about applying maximum pressure, General. This is a policy that failed before. It failed because it was meant to limit Iran's nuclear activities, and it didn't do that. It was meant to lower regional tensions, and it didn't do that. And you want to make the same mistake again, applying maximum pressure. You told the Jewish Insider last month, let's forget about a JCPOA. There's no chance to go back, but to create pressure again based on political isolation of the regime as well as crippling economic sanctions. Who says there's no chance of going back to the JCPOA? You've got all the permanent members of the Security Council, plus Germany, investing huge effort in getting the deal back. What are you trying to do? Undermine the talks now? You want the talks to fail?
What you have said is absolutely right. But nowadays, my proposal to the U.S. administration, let's create a coalition again, as it was in 2012, in 2015, as it was in 2010, when in the United Nations Security Council, we had China and Russia on board voting for sanctions. And unfortunately, the Trump policy actually broke down the coalition. The Biden administration should create again a coalition which will impose pressure on the regime, crippling economic sanctions on the regime, and having a credible military option to threaten the regime to come back to the dilemma of survivability or going on with rogue activities, on top of it, the nuclear project.
Yes, but what really undermines the talks at the moment is your Prime Minister, Naftali Bennett, going around saying, well, whatever the deal is, I'm not going to be bound by it. Does he really want the talks to fail? He said, Israel's not bound by what will be written in the agreements if they're signed, and Israel will continue to maintain full freedom of action anywhere, anytime, with no constraints. How do you think that looks in Tehran? What's the point of the Iranians even turning up for the talks if, irrespective of the results, you're going to bomb them if you feel like it? What's the point of them even turning up?
The Israeli policy is very clear. By one way or another, the military nuclear project in Iran should be stopped. Of course, we prefer to reach it by diplomacy, by sanctions, and not by military operation. But if this is what will be the only option, by one way or another, the military nuclear project should be stopped. Now, we allow the U.S. administration to be engaged. We are involved now, as it wasn't the case in the time of Obama. Unfortunately, we were not involved in the negotiations. We are involved. We have open channels with the administration. And hopefully, this administration will come out with such a policy that will reach again the achievement of putting the Iranian regime in what I mentioned, a dilemma of survivability or going on with rogue activities, not just the nuclear activities. Iran had become to be the destabilizer in the region, in Lebanon, in Yemen, in Iraq, in Syria, in North Africa. So I believe that even the international community shouldn't tolerate this kind of Iranian policy. That's what I propose.
But instead of waving a stick at them the whole time, why not offer some carrots instead? That was the advantage of the deal, which you so hated in 2015 and now wish you still had. It gave the moderates in Iran some leverage. It gave them economic incentives and sanctions relief. But you didn't like that. You didn't like that either. But that was what was key to them, and that strengthened the position of the moderates inside Iran. The moderates are nowhere now in Iran, are they?
Sanctions relief might be able only after reaching the goal of giving up the nuclear project. It is not a civilian one. There is no dispute about it, although it was in the past. It's a military project, by all means. They should give up it. Then we can be able to talk about sanctions relief, and not vice versa.
You say it's a military project, but you admitted you have no idea if Iran is going to produce a bomb or not. You told the Jewish Insider last month, we don't know about whether they make any progress on the military dimension of the project. We believe they're still very cautious, very careful not to do it, because they're afraid of the response. If that's true, why all the hostile rhetoric and the threats about bombing, if you don't even know whether they intend to have a bomb?
Tim, if it is, looks like a duck, swims like a duck, flies like a duck, it's a duck. It's a military project. Now, if the Iranian regime wasn't challenged by the international community, as well as by Israel, we believe that they would have reached a nuclear bomb years ago. You know, I served as the head of the intelligence in the 90s. We sought to believe that in a success-oriented process, they might reach the bomb within a decade. Because of they were challenged diplomatically, economically, militarily, covert operations, they haven't reached it.
General Yaalon, let's talk a bit about the Palestinians, if we may. 2 months ago, UN human rights experts expressed alarm at the growing incidence of settler violence directed at Palestinians. They say these are the highest recorded levels in recent years. Last year, up to the end of October, the UN logged 410 attacks by settlers on Palestinians, 302 against property, 108 against individuals. Why does your government, do you think, view that as acceptable? It lets the numbers of these attacks rise every year.
I condemn any violation, any violence perpetrated by Jews against Palestinians. This is not we shouldn't allow militias. But the problem is that we tried again and again, I would have said, since the dawn of Zionism, to have any kind of understanding with the Palestinians, what is called territorial compromise. And in any case in history, to include after Oslo, and with Abu Mazen as well, we faced violence as a result to any Israeli proposal for territorial compromise. So I can't see what we call a final settlement to the horizon. On the other hand, we should do what I did as a defense minister to improve the situation economically, infrastructure, security. But you know, since the dawn of Zionism, we haven't met a Palestinian leadership which are ready to live with us side by side, the Jewish state and a Palestinian state. And this is the main challenge. This is the main gap, which was understood by many Oslo as well.
Let's come back to the violence, because as you said, you promised 8 years ago that you would deal with this issue of settler violence. You said, we will not permit marginal, extreme and violent groups to take control by force of land that is not theirs in violation of the law or to threaten Palestinian residents who are working their own land. That's what you said almost exactly 8 years ago. But that's exactly also what Israel has allowed them to do, the settlers to do, over and over again. At the end of 2020, your government had approved 138 settlements in the West Bank, but you tolerated 150 outposts, even though they're illegal. Aren't these the very land grabs that you pledged 8 years ago to stop?
You know, you can go back to my role as a chief of general staff and defense minister. I didn't tolerate any illegal activity, whether it is settlement or violence against Palestinians. And that should be the Israeli policy. But no doubt that the Jewish violence, not to compare to terror that Jews are attacked. It's not an excuse to allow Jewish violence. I'm against it. But no doubt that the main element which affect the relationship between Israel and the Palestinian is the Palestinian terror, which unfortunately generated by Arafat. It is ignored in many cases by Mahmoud Abbas, not talking about Hamas and Palestinian Islamic Jihad, and we should fight it back in order to allow the Palestinian today in Judea and Samaria to live in a peace, in enjoying dignity, a welfare, whatever. But you know, we disengaged from Gaza. We evacuated all the Jews from Gaza. Why should the Gazans, the Palestinians from Gaza, launch rockets against Tel Aviv? Because they don't see the end of the conflict along what is called the lines of 67. And this is a challenge. So we should manage it. We should act accordingly. But nevertheless, in one hand, I don't want to see bilateral, I don't want to see a binational state in Israel, as well as I don't see a final settlement to the horizon. So we should manage the conflict in a way that we'll be able to settle it in the future.
The issue of settler violence has caused big divisions inside the cabinet of Naftali Bennett. Earlier this month, the Deputy Economy Minister, Yair Golan, singled out settlers from the West Bank Homesh outpost, calling them subhuman after they vandalized gravestones in a nearby Palestinian village. The response from the Prime Minister was, these are shocking generalizations bordering on blood libel. Settlement activity in the West Bank represents modern day pioneering. In other words, us settlers can do no wrong. Why do you think, with your hindsight and with your benefit of having been defense minister, why do you think that the government is still pretending that all the settlers are angels and turning a blind eye to this violence? Because this violence matters. You say it's not the main issue. It matters enormously to Palestinians trying to have a decent life on the land that you've left them.
Tim, you look at the Israeli-Palestinian conflict from the settler violence point of view.
It's a big issue. I don't tolerate
any violence perpetrated by the settlers.
But your government does. Your government does.
There is no even a single team. There is no a single settler in the Gaza Strip. Why should the Palestinians from the Gaza Strip launch rockets to Tel Aviv? So, you know, the problem is not the way that you look at it. And I condemn and don't tolerate any violence perpetrated by Jews.
There's another aspect of this that's alarming. A number of reports have surfaced that Israeli soldiers have stood by and watched Palestinians being attacked and then turned on some of the victims themselves. Why do you think that has been happening?
Tim, you look at certain videotapes which are concentrating on such a behavior, and this is not the case. The role and the orders to the Israeli soldiers as well as the policemen deployed in Judea and Samaria is not to allow such violence. In certain point, you might take a picture in which you see the soldiers watching. At the end of the day, they operate against the violence of the settlers. This is their mission, and they should do it this way.
For years, the world has been told that you have the most moral army in the world. We're also told that you investigate accusations of excessive force, but it's very rare that a soldier is held culpable. And if he is, the explanation is almost always that he was just one rotten apple or a wild weed, as you call them. Do you go along with that?
We keep in the IDF very strict moral values, as well as rules of engagement. Just looking back to what I dealt with when I served as a defense minister, the incident with a soldier in Hebron, which was at the end sentenced and imprisoned because he shot in the head of neutralized terrorist when he wasn't under any risk of life. Those are our values. And we impose it very strictly. That's the way it is. In certain cases, unfortunately, we had to deal with soldiers or policemen who do not obey the rules or keep our values. That's why we claim yes. The IDF is a very high moral army, and the commanders keep the rules and the values very strictly.
A man who would take issue with that is Colonel Shlomi Tzipori, who's defended a number of soldiers accused of mistreating prisoners. He asked one of them recently if he'd been briefed by his superiors on how to treat people in detention who no longer posed a threat. The soldier said he had been briefed. His commanders had told him not to leave marks showing that a prisoner had been beaten up. So the only issue for this soldier, and presumably others as well, was how to beat up their detainees and not leave marks. Is that the symbol of a moral army?
Tim, it is not so simple to judge a soldier in a very intense situation, in which in certain cases he might be wrong in judging the situation. A soldier, I know, and we investigate every case. It might be seen under intense situation that someone is a terrorist, but at the end of the day, after investigating it, it might be a wrong judgment. But we investigate any case. You know, you deal with it as the Israeli soldiers violate all the rules, are immoral. You know that even in defensive shield operation or in a protective edge operation, and I know what I'm talking about, in both operations I was participating as a chief of general staff or as a defense minister. At the end of the day, when we talked about non-involved casualties, the numbers, not to compare to what was done in Afghanistan or in Iraq, when you operate in a civilian environment in which the terrorists are using the civilians as human shield, you might kill uninvolved to make a collateral damage. But we judge and we investigate any situation after reaching such a consequences. So yes, I claim and I insist on it. The IDF is a moral army, keeping moral values, dealing with it in a more strict way than any armed forces in the world.
Israel's current defense minister, Benny Gantz, told the US last month his government is taking steps to build trust with the Palestinians. The current government doesn't even mention the Palestinians, but it's clear that the idea of a two-state solution is over. They don't want, and the Prime Minister has made it clear, he's not going to give the Palestinians a state. Why should the Palestinians talk to you if that, their major hope, has been ruled out? Why should they bother?
You know that even late Mr. Rabin, as a Prime Minister and Defense Minister, said about the vision that he looked, envisioned as a prime minister a month before his unfortunate assassination. He said that the Palestinian Authority will be at the end less than a state. They agreed to be demilitarized, and we are responsible to overall security. They understand they are dependent on us. The shekel is their currency. Their economy is dependent on Israel, the infrastructure, water supply, electricity. This is a unique situation. So they call themselves the Palestinian Empire. It is, at the end, is less than a state, autonomy or whatever. This is the case. This is the reality.
It's the reality because you impose it after 54 years of occupation. That's the reality, isn't it?
Tim, you are very wrong. I come to Israel and I show you what we did in Judea and Samaria, and I served there as a Judea and Samaria division commander, OC of Central Command, of course, as a chief of general staff. They enjoy already political independence. They have their own parliament, government, president. It's up to them. And they decided to be divided into two different entities. One is the Palestinian Authority in Judea and Samaria, and one is Hamastan. It's up to them. We are not deployed anymore in Gaza. They decided to manufacture rockets rather than to export whatever. This is their decision, their choice. They are more determined and committed to destroy Israel rather than to build their own political entity. This is the case, this is the reality that I can tell you about.
We could talk about this much longer, and I'm sure we could argue over it much longer. But for the moment, General Moshe Ya'alon, thanks very much for being on Conflict Zone. Thank you for your time.